there's a lie being pushed or trying to be pushed. It ain't going nowhere. That Deacon Lava,
oh no,
myself, Captain Shem, Captain Isaac, Captain Hannah, that we went to Africa to deal with prostitutes, smoke weed, and have sex with little African boys.
Damn.
And the video, you know, our black people love drama. People love drama.
There's a whole lot you could say on that.
I know.
You really have to think. You really have to think for someone, whoever that may be, that would put that out there. You have to already know that the audience is desiring to hear such garbage.
But that's all right. We love our people. We love our brothers that sow such discord against us. Lord, be merciful upon them. Please, get me Psalms 40:4. But I do have a message for any of us in here and are listening. If we accustom ourselves, give me that scripture. You know what that is? Don't accustom yourself to lying.
Sirach 7:13. Use not to make any manner of lie.
That's it.
For the custom thereof is not good.
So, brothers, you may get angry at certain things people may say against you or me or the leadership. Don't accustom yourself to lying. The Most High is not going to roll with you. He will take his spirit from you, as a matter of fact. Did we read Psalms 40:4?
No, sir.
Read that.
Psalms 40:4. Blessed is that man that maketh the Lord his trust and respecteth not the proud, nor such as turn aside to lies.
So the Bible says, blessed is the man that makes the Lord his trust and respects not the proud, nor such as turn aside to lies. So you may believe that we spent money to go to Africa to deal with prostitutes, smoke weed, and boy booty. That's a lie, brothers and sisters. That is a lie. Give me Psalms 101:7.
We often talk about how people will have spirits. Like we speak about, let's say we know a hole in New York. And say, you know what, I'm leaving and I'm going to California or something. And then the next thing you know, or it could be some brothers. We have brothers that was in the wickedness here. And they say, you know what, I'm going to go and do something else. And go down there and have the exact same problem. My point is that nobody's going to go over anywhere and commit something that you've never seen here.
Exactly. Psalms 101:7.
Psalms 101:7. He that worketh deceit shall not dwell within my house.
Brothers, listen. You sisters too. Any of us in here listening right now that deal deceitfully, the Most High says, you will not dwell in his house, meaning his kingdom. You will not be there. Go ahead.
He that telleth lies shall not tarry in my sight.
God don't deal with liars. So we pray that our brothers repent. We really do. Give me Psalms 5, verse 9 and 10.
What the bishop is saying is heavy, because we pray, when the scripture said, love thine enemies, this is what it's talking about.
Thank you. Exactly.
This is the scripture. That scripture there is what we're speaking about now, hoping that they will repent. When you do that, that's how the Lord blesses. That's how the Lord is blessing IUIC, because we do things like this. In the face of all of this evil that's going on with our own brothers, we're still asking the Lord to forgive them, for they know not what they do.
Psalms 5:9. For there is no faithfulness in their mouth. Their inward part is very wickedness. Their throat is an open sepulcher.
See that part? Their throat is an open. You know what a sepulcher is? A graveyard. Dead stuff comes out. An open graveyard. Everything that comes out their mouth is evil, filthy, and of the dead. Go ahead.
They flatter with their tongue.
That's each other. Go ahead.
Destroy thou them, O God.
You see what David said? Tag. This is heavy. Go ahead.
Let them fall by their own counsels.
When you have a counsel like we just read in Psalms 1, blessed is the man. I can't quote that. What did it say?
Blessed is
that
the man.
That walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly.
That walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. Meaning, you're sitting around men that says, hey, let's tell a lie on Jonah and call it a prophecy. And all your counsel, yeah, let's do that. The Bible says, no, no, no. Somebody got to go, no. I got to leave, y'all. Exactly. I got to get up and break. I got to get out of here. Y'all trying to get me killed. That's what a righteous man would do or say. Read it again, Captain.
Destroy thou them, O God. Let them fall by their own counsels.
Let them fall by their own counsel. Meaning you're going to fall. The pit you dig for others, you shall fall into it yourself. Go ahead.
Cast them out in the multitude of their transgressions, for they have rebelled against thee.
So David's talking about Israelites. And no, I'm not driving around arresting innocent black people. That's a lie, too. I don't care what the newspaper said. That is a lie. And you know what's funny? Because they said it's unusual that the city of New York pays that amount of money to those two boys. You better be right. That is so true. The city of New York will never pay that amount of money to two people unless the case was so clear cut because they got information to help them out. But nobody thinks about that. So it was so heavy, in fact, the city of New York said, we can't do nothing but pay these boys. And guess what? If there's any type of dealing with black police officers, black law enforcement, if there's, I'm talking about black and Latino, Captain Aparam, you back me up on this one. If there's any type of corruption, police corruption that black cops do,
they should know the answer to that.
Guess what happens?
Who can answer that?
Do you think they get the same pass as the white boys get? Oh, hell no. They're thrown under the bus. And ran over, backed that bus up, Willie.
Right.
That's what happens.
Drag him through the mud.
Exactly. That is what happens. So don't, our people are simple.
Not even an indictment. Nothing.
Exactly. So they said, well, if I did some corruption, why wasn't I fired? Why didn't I get desk duty? Why didn't anything happen?
Not even questioned.
This is the foolishness of our people. From there, give me Jeremiah. Chapter 9 and verse 5.
Hey, Elder, brothers don't care whether you did evil or not. You know, it's just running. It's just to run with slander. That's all it is.
That's the real deal. They already know the deal.
Exactly. But
all the stuff that you just said, all these Negroes know that.
Exactly.
But they just wanted to run with something that they think Negroes want to hear.
And let me tell you another thing of how the law works. Let's say any one of you, any sister, whatever. Any one of you who gets robbed, beat up, stabbed, assaulted, whatever. If you go to any law enforcement, they will say, who did it? You may say, I don't know the name. I know where the person lives, or I know what they look like. Then, based upon, listen good to what I'm saying, some of you notice, some of you might not know. Based upon what the witness or victim says. Based upon what the victim or the witness says, law enforcement carries out the execution.
Jeremiah 9 and verse 5.
Uh-huh.
And they will deceive everyone his neighbor.
Uh-oh.
And will not speak the truth.
And will not what?
Speak the truth.
They will not speak the truth. Go ahead.
They have taught their tongue to speak lies.
They have taught, meaning they have practiced lying. This, if you hear somebody lying, it ain't the first time they lied. Some people I have discovered are professional liars.
Professional liars.
They will not blink. Their eye will not go to the left. Their eye will not go to the right. These are things you look for when you're interviewing somebody to see which way the eyes shift, their face. You ever see somebody, they get that little twitch? And you know they lie. Nah, look at them twitching. Or they start doing something else. Or some people are, no, I don't know. There's some other little nervous habit they may do. These people are professional liars. Read that again, Captain.
And they will deceive everyone his neighbor and will not speak the truth. They have taught their tongue to speak lies and weary themselves to commit iniquity.
And weary themselves to commit. You know what it means to weary yourself? Day in, day out. You're sitting around counseling about evil, lying. You're wearying yourself because guess what? You're wearying yourself because in the end, you will die. In the end, not just you, but all your counselors around you, not just them, but their wives who are privy to it and say nothing, and their children who are part. When you read the Bible, the Most High just don't get that one man. He get everybody in the family. Like when you read the book of Esther, it wasn't just Haman that got killed. Esther said not just him, his wife and his 10 sons, Everybody was in cahoots. So when you sit back and you say to yourself, I want to concoct a lie against a brother or a sister, you better watch out. Jump to verse 4, Deacon Nathan said.
Verse 4, take ye heed, every one of his neighbor, and trust ye not in any brother, for every brother will utterly supplant, and every neighbor will walk with slanders.
One more time.
Trust ye heed, every one of his neighbor.
Read again. Take ye heed.
Take ye heed, every one of his neighbor.
You know what that means, take ye heed? It means be mindful. Listen to what they say. Don't just run with a slander. Go ahead.
And trust ye not in any brother.
Because they'll lie. Why?
For every brother will utterly supplant.
What does supplant mean? What does supplant mean? That's what Jacob's name means. What does supplant mean? Ezekiel. Officer Ezekiel. What does supplant mean?
You gotta turn Ithon's mic up, please. Turn his microphone up, so.
Supplant means to root up or take over.
Right. It means the person that wants to remove you out the way and be on top. That's what supplant means. So most brothers will do that to push you out the way so they can be in the forefront. That vainglory spirit.
Preeminence.
Preeminence. Thank you. That's the word. That's what that comes from. Read again.
Take ye heed, every one of his neighbor, and trust ye not in any brother, for every brother will utterly supplant.
Go ahead.
And every neighbor will walk with slanders.
The same one that will utterly supplant is the same one that walks with slanders. For example, I got to say it. The elder going all the way to the other side of the world with the captains and officers. Elders going to the other side of the world. They went all over there to teach Hamites. The Bible says, Laba, correct me if I'm wrong. Is Israel on all four corners of Harlem or all four corners of the earth? I'm just confused. I don't know. Maybe the Most High just took all of us and just put us on this side of the world. I'm trying to keep me nice. That's a reprobate mind to think that the Lord would have Israel only on one side of the world when there's four corners of it. The Lord has Israel scattered, remnants of us scattered everywhere. There's a majority of us are here. Remnants, like Isaiah 11 says we're everywhere else. So for us to go over there and reach our people over there, those who say we're teaching Hamites are those who don't have the reach to go over there.
Thank
their
you.
Numbers That's are the small. Their That's arms the are too short. So they'll go, oh, those are Hamites anyway. No, they're not. You can't get over there. Your reach is too short. So you're going to lie and call them Hamites because you're too
you
ashamed. Because of the shame is too bad. Okay, those are Hamites over there. We see through the smoke screen. We see it. Your arms are too short. So let the big boys handle the big matters. Let the big camp handle the big matters and go to the side of the world.
Hey, Deacon Ithon, you know what I'm about to say, don't you?
Yes,
I didn't want those grapes anyway.
Yeah, those grapes anyway.
Yeah, you know, Deacon Ithon, because, you know, brothers and sisters been giving monies for years. They have not done nothing. Yep. That's why they're afraid now, because we open doors now. We say, hey, now the people say, what happened to the money we giving you? You haven't made no move. You still in a place for like 20 years. You have not moved. You understand? You don't have nothing to show for the people who have given you their money. But when we get to IUIC, we show what we do with their money. We show brothers and sisters where we go. When we go there, we show pictures. Not we tell you we've been there. We showing you pictures. Videos we've been there. So these guys say, whoa, IUIC gonna, what a sister said to me, don't blow up my spot. IUIC is a spot book. We gonna break every spot of brothers who saying walk in the spirit of Christ.
Yep. Okay, Lava, all right. Give me a Jeremiah 14:14. Jeremiah 14:14.
Jeremiah 14:14. Then the Lord said unto me, the prophets prophesy lies in my name.
You will have brothers who will say, will give you prophecies and say, how will you know a prophet? These men went to Africa and dealt with prostitutes, smoked weed, and banged boy booty. And said they have the proof.
But wait for it.
Read that again.
Then the Lord said unto me, the prophets prophesy lies in my name. I sent them not, neither have I commanded them, neither spake unto them. They prophesy unto you a false vision and divination, and a thing of naught, and the deceit of their heart.
So be very weary with some of these Israelite camps. Like, I'm going to say it again. These scriptures are not coming out of hatred. Because I know me, several other brothers, I remember back in the day, Jan, Liam, Isaac, we watch all the camp. We go, oh, yeah, this, I like the way this brother brought that out. We didn't just watch IOS. We watched all the camps to see who's teaching what's going on. It's what we do. But now you see the turn. And this is when we were relatively small. And as our camp started to grow, those same men that we once may have admired started to go, I hate them. They're this, they're that. Like, whoa, 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 they're cursing us. What the hell's going on here?
And people are seeing that too. It's a lot of people are seeing that same spirit going out there. They say, wait a minute, what the hell's wrong with you guys? You acting like niggas now. That's exactly what they're saying to them.
Jeremiah 23:21. So again, we pray that all our people repent. The one-third repent. We really do. Those in the truth and without. Jeremiah 23:21.
I have not sent these prophets, yet they ran. I have not spoken to them, yet they prophesied.
Jump down to verse 32.
Behold, I am against them that prophesy false dreams, saith the Lord, and do tell them, and cause my people to err by their lies and by their lightness. Yet I sent them not, nor commanded them. Therefore they shall not profit this people at all, saith the Lord.
So if you ever hear us say, you can buy, cook, and sell on the Sabbath, you better beware of us. Because we're telling you outright that it's okay to break God's laws. Everybody understand that? So avoid that. Give me Ephesians 4:29.
Can I say something real quick, yeah, Bishop? Earlier we was going over the Ten Commandments, right? A lot of people that you hear telling these false doctrines, what do they have in their hands? Bibles. We read a commandment earlier, do not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. That's an example of it. Mm-hmm. The example that he just gave.
Come on.
Ephesians 4:29. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth.
Let me explain corrupt communication. Corrupt communication, first and foremost, deals with lying against the scriptures. Corrupt communication, foremost after that, deals with lying against your brother, your neighbor. Corrupt communication also means using words when you speak, opprobrious words. Give me that. Y'all pulled it earlier. Oh, you got that one's right. Sirach 23:17. Precepts with this about corrupt communication. And can we look up the word opprobrious, please?
Sirach 23:15.
I can't even spell it. I know it's two P's. Okay, go ahead.
The man that is accustomed to opprobrious words.
Okay, can we look it? Somebody look it up for us. What does it mean?
Opprobrium. Harsh criticism.
Harsh criticism.
Or censor. Mm-hmm. Vilification, abuse.
You said vilification?
Vilification. Vilification, appropriate.
Okay. Expressing scorn or criticism. Dang. Abusive. I don't know what, I can't even pronounce that one with the V. Vitue, whatever. Derogatory. I know that one. Disparaging. I don't know what that is. Insulting. I know what that one is. Offensive. Defamatory. I don't know what that next one is. I don't know what that next one is either. Venomous. I know what that one is. Scornful. Contemptuous. Oh, I even know that one. Derisive. I think bitchy. Ooh! I know that word right there. So it says don't use bitchy words. That's what it says. Go back to that one, Sirach.
23:15. The man that is accustomed to opprobrious words.
Opprobrious words, insulting, defamatory, B-I-T-C-H-Y words. Go ahead.
Will never be reformed.
Wait. The Bible says what?
Will never be reformed.
Will never be changed. You know what it means to be accustomed to that? That you've lived your life doing that. You have never repented. You have never been born again. Wow. Go ahead. Was that it?
Will never be reformed all the days of his life.
Wow. So now let's go back to Ephesians 4 and verse 29 again.
Let no corrupt communication.
So corrupt communication deals with opprobrious words, insulting, hateful, scornful, derogatory, B-I-T-C-H-Y words. Go ahead.
Proceed out of your mouth.
The Bible says don't teach like that. Don't talk like that. Go ahead.
But that which is good to the use of edifying.
But that which is good should come out of your mouth. Meaning what? God's laws. Why? Because it edifies the listeners. Go ahead.
That it may minister grace unto the hearers.
That it may minister forgiveness and mercy unto the hearers. That's what the leaders and men and servants of the one true God must do. And if we're not doing it yet, lest we must practice it. Everybody understand that? Give me Revelation 22, 14 and 15. So you prostitute buyers and you weed smokers and you boy booty bangers, the Lord has a heavy message for us all. Come on.
Revelation 22, verse 14. Blessed are they that do his commandments. That they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city.
I don't know about y'all up in here, but I want to be in this number. What about y'all?
Yes, sir.
But let's read the stipulation. Come on.
For without.
Outside of the gates.
Are dogs and sorcerers and whoremongers.
Go ahead.
And murderers and idolaters.
Here it comes.
And whosoever loveth and maketh a lie.
Do y'all see that? So you are not going to inherit the kingdom being a liar. I want everybody to understand that. Everyone, male and female, men and women, boy and girl, liars, the Most High said you're not entering the kingdom. You might think a lie is a little thing. I just told a white lie. It's just a little lie. God, don't deal with that. Your lies are used to hurt people, destroy people. The Most High says, no, I'm not dealing with you.
You know what's dangerous about when you get into the spirit of lying and slander and the things like that? It brings a momentum with it. Once you begin to get accustomed, that's the word, once you begin to get accustomed to it, it begins to bring its own support to the point where you become reprobate and you don't even realize that you're heading into destruction. And it begins to carry. And as a matter of fact, you will continue to watch that spirit on those people and you won't even recognize them.
Amen.
I don't know if y'all realize what I'm talking about. You actually see the change as they continue to go down, down, down.
Hey,
and they get worse. Right. They wax worse and worse. And they don't even realize it. It's scary. Don't play with that spirit. Do not play with that spirit. It's a deceiving spirit that will destroy you.
Hey, Isaac, read that again. Can I bring a one point, Ella?
Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. For without are dogs and sorcerers and whoremongers and murderers and idolaters and whosoever loveth and maketh a lie.
And whosoever loveth and maketh a lie. A lot of times, you know, we be dealing with brothers and sisters, right? And a lot of times they come to us and they be just lying. And a lot of times, let me tell you all something, man. You all think we idiots. But a lot of time we see through the lie. Be like, watch out, this dude. This dude full of shit. You know? A lot of time brothers come to us and straight up light us. They don't you brothers don't understand you're playing with your life when you all do that, man. You're playing with your life. Because when we read about that that brother and his wife that lied in Acts, it tell you that they was put to death. They was put to death, man. So you brothers that come around us with that lying spirit, you brothers and sisters. Because even last week we had to deal with that. You got brothers telling sisters, listen, you got to know how to talk to the leadership. You can't tell them too much. Don't give them too much. Don't give them too little. Just give them enough for them. But and brothers talking like that, and they don't understand. We be seeing the lie. We be like, after you leave talking the lie, we be like, you know that brother full of shit, right? You know he lying, right? And we be here watching you as an idiot, and you walking away like thinking like you lied to us. Let me let you all know. You all don't be lying to us, man. You all be just fooling yourselves. So the scripture say, if you lie, you're not going to get the kingdom. So stop lying. And why lie? Why lie, man? Why put on a front?
Can I say something real quick, Bishop? Look at read verse 15 again. I want y'all to notice something.
For without are dogs.
For without our dogs, listen, go ahead.
And sorcerers.
Sorcerers, go ahead.
And whoremongers.
Whoremongers.
And murderers.
Murderers.
And idolaters.
Idolaters.
And whosoever loveth and maketh a lie.
The Most High put all of these spirits in the same basket. So if you think a lie is small, think about somebody who's committing sorcery. Think about a murderer, a whoremonger. All of those things are tied together.
Bishop.
So there's no such thing as, like I was talking about earlier, little white lie. That's BS. A lie is going. A lie is just as bad as a sorcerer. Would any of you practice sorcery? No. So why lie then? It's the same thing.
Go ahead. Deacon Malachi said, why lie? And that's the question. Why would these people lie? Why would not only the ones that come up here and lie to us, but the ones that would sit down and... Because in the video when the lie was told that the other group did, they said that they've been sitting and they've been waiting. They've been sitting and they've been waiting. Those were the exact words. They've been waiting for something. Because people look at the growth. People look at the accomplishments that are being made to bring the truth to our people. And you have some people that sit on the sidelines. And there's history of that in the Bible to explain why would a person lie. Give me... John chapter 11, verse 45. John chapter 11, verse 45.
John chapter 11, verse 45. Then many of the Jews which came to Mary and had seen the things which Jesus did believed on him.
People started to believe on Christ when they saw the works that he put in. Read on.
But some of them went their ways to the Pharisees.
And you had some other people that went to the Pharisees. Those were the leaders at that time who were ruling. So some believed on Christ when they saw the great things he did. But you had some people that were so evil, they went back to the Pharisees who were against Christ and did this. Read on.
And told them what things Jesus had done.
Started to give them a report of how Christ was moving in the city and the momentum he was gaining of the people. Read on.
Then gathered the chief priests and the Pharisees a council and said, what do we?
They didn't say, look, this man is bringing everybody to the Most High. This man is gathering the elect of God. Everybody's looking at him. They said, what do we? What should we do about the momentum he's gaining with the people? Read on.
For this man doeth many miracles. If we let him thus alone, all men will believe on him.
And that's what they worried about. Why they will sit down and say, we need to make up lies. If we leave IUIC alone, people are going to start to listen to them and follow them. Read on.
And the Romans shall come and take away both our place and nation.
And we won't have the position that we have amongst the people that we have now. So this is what they did at that council. Give me... Matthew chapter 26, verse 59. Because the question is, why would they lie? What will be the purpose? What will be the benefit of them coming and saying such a bold-faced lie?
Wait a minute, Deacon. Before you go, could you look at 46 and 47 again?
But some of them went their ways to the Pharisees and told them what things Jesus had done.
So the great things that Jesus had done was on their minds. And that caused them to do what we're reading in 47.
Then gathered the chief priests.
The then took place when they realized what was happening. When they realized that Christ was going, having all this stuff going on outside, they said, because of that, we got to move against them. That's what I want to do to draw out.
You they realized that Christ was doing things that have never been done before with the nation.
And that caused them.
Okay, so that's what moved them with envy. That's what moved them with hatred. That's what moved them to say, look, we got to stop this man. Okay, go to Matthew chapter 26, verse 59. This is what they did when they took the council.
Now the chief priests and elders and all the council sought false witness against Jesus.
They did what?
Sought false witness against Jesus.
We can't stop him lawfully. We cannot catch him in anything, doing anything wrong to the people. So we got to do what?
Sought false witness against Jesus.
We got to find a way to make up lies, to convince the people of lies. Slander. Why would somebody say all these men got on a plane to go to another continent to go and have gay sex and smoke weed? Those people catch you over there, they will burn you. They won't let you out the city alive.
You go and speak before all those people and that's what's on your mind? That's a sick mind. Why are you even taking your mind there to that place of homosexuality?
Exactly. Well, there's another lie that's being pushed out there that when the Bible teaches one wife that that is a homosexual doctrine. And I thought to myself, I said, well, that'll make no sense because the Bible does say, can we read that 1 Timothy 3 and first give me 1 Corinthians 7 and 2.
1 Corinthians 7 and verse 2. Nevertheless, to avoid fornication.
To avoid being a whoremonger. To avoid homosexuality. To avoid bestiality. To avoid incest.
Let every man have his own wife.
Brother, have your own wife. Go ahead.
And let every woman.
And you sisters.
Have her own husband.
Have your own husband. Now, if that's gay, then what is verse 1? Read verse 1.
Now, concerning the things whereof ye wrote unto me, it is good for a man not to touch a woman.
So what would you say about the Apostle Paul? If having one wife means you are homosexual, then what is it when you don't want no wife? A lot of times when men speak, they don't think about the implications of what's coming out of their mouth. They are so hell-bent on destroying men trying to keep God's laws, they will say anything, not realizing the evil against not just us. How many wives did Christ have? None. How many did John the Baptist have? So what are these men, homosexuals? You must be mindful when you speak, brothers. You're so angry. Don't let anger get the best. It says, be angry, but sin not. That's what the Bible says. Does it say that?
Yes, it does.
So,
Bishop, yes, go to the seventh verse.
The what?
The seventh verse there.
Verse 7. For I would that all men were even as I myself.
He said, I wish all the men could be like me. Read on.
But every man hath his proper gift of God, one after this manner and another after that.
Read verse 8.
I say therefore to the unmarried and widows.
The people that decide we're not going to deal in any relationship. Read on.
It is good for them if they abide even as I.
So those people are gay? Those people are gay? Okay, Paul is gay. Christ is gay. Daniel is gay. You know how much men in the scriptures did not have no sexual relations? And they're saying that we're gay because we decided, according to the scriptures, we're going to follow the law and just deal with one woman. And here it is that they're saying that to do the best thing for you to do is not deal with none at all.
Exactly. That's what happened in Matthew 19. Let's get that. Verse 10 to 12.
Matthew 19 and verse 10.
And again, we do pray that our brothers repent. Understand what we're saying. Our job is to lead you men and women on the path of righteousness. Because when we're gone, if we're still in this wicked kingdom, the next tier of leadership will have to step up. And Lord, I pray that you are able, we are here to enable you, groom you, I like that word, to teach and deal properly. Read.
Matthew 19 and verse 10. His disciples say unto him, if the case of the man be so with his wife.
Meaning, if you can't leave her except for fornication, that's what he's talking about.
It is not good to marry.
It is not good to marry. That's what one of the disciples said to Christ. Go ahead.
But he said unto them, all men cannot receive this saying.
He said, everybody, he said, listen, yeah, you're right, but all brothers can't receive that. Go ahead.
Save they to whom it is given.
Uh-huh.
For there are some eunuchs which were so born from their mother's womb.
Meaning what? They dedicated them? No, they was born missing their private parts. Males. Their private part does not work. Thank you. Go ahead.
And there are some eunuchs which were made eunuchs of men.
Like Daniel, when they cut off your penis, your rod. Go ahead.
And there be eunuchs which have made themselves eunuchs for the kingdom of heaven's sake.
That's Paul. That was Christ. That was John the Baptist. Meaning they decided they would not deal with a woman. That's what that's talking about. Christ said all men cannot receive that. That's why Paul said it's better to what? Marry than to... Get the scripture, because some of y'all don't know. Get that scripture. 1 Corinthians 7. What verse is that? 9?
Verse 9.
Yeah, read that.
1 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 9. But if they cannot contain, let them marry. For it is better to marry than to burn.
Right, to burn sexually. But if they cannot, if you cannot contain yourself sexually, Paul says, through the Spirit of the Lord, get married. It's better to marry than to burn. Give me Matthew 5, 44. Read that for me.
Matthew 5, verse 44. But I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you.
So that's what we're going through now. Because many people will come in this truth and attempt to use us. You may get away with it once. You might even get away with it twice. But daggone it, you ain't getting away with it three times.
You think you got away.
Right. There is a God. There is a God. Give me John 14, 26. You liars up in here, I tell you. But the Most High has a plan. We're gonna just keep it moving. The Most High has a plan for his people, the nation of Israel. Read that.
John 14, verse 26. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance.
And you know these people that claim they got the Holy Ghost, ask them, okay, the Holy Ghost will bring all things to your remembrance. What's your nationality? They can never answer that. Proving you don't have the Holy Ghost. Stop the lies. Stop the lies. So Christ said the Most High would give us the Holy Ghost, and he shall bring all things to our remembrance. A part of this remembrance, give me Jeremiah 17. To bring something to your remembrance means you at one time had it and lost it. You forgot it. Give me that in Jeremiah 17, 4, please.
Jeremiah 17, verse 4. And thou, even thyself, shalt discontinue from thine heritage.
You would discontinue from your heritage. Go ahead.
That I gave thee.
Uh-huh.
And I will cause thee to serve thine enemies in the land which thou knowest not.
So in John 14, 26, Christ said, and read it again, John 14, 26.
But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost,
uh-huh,
whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance.
So one of the things being brought back to our remembrance that we discontinued from was our heritage. Go back to Jeremiah 17, 4. Thank you.
And thou, even thyself, shalt discontinue from thine heritage.
This is why we need the Holy Ghost. In order to get the Holy Ghost, we must, Christ said, if you love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he shall send you another comforter. Verse 26 said that this Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, shall bring all things to your remembrance. A part of the things coming to our remembrance now is our heritage that we once had, which we discontinued from. We do one more again.
And thou, even thyself, shalt discontinue from thine heritage that I gave thee, and I will cause thee to serve thine enemies in the land which thou knowest not. For ye have kindled a fire in mine anger, which shall burn forever.
So there are three main things. We had this when we were in Vegas. Captain Yahshua. Captain Yahshua, we were reading an article where they were talking about three main steps. And it was pretty good, a good article. But it dealt with, I'll change the words a bit, heritage, education, and economics. Heritage. Write that down. Education and economics. Those three things. Now, I just want to touch on them in brief. So we lost our heritage. The Holy Ghost is restoring that to us.
Thy testimonies have I taken as an heritage forever, for they are the rejoicing of my heart.
So God's testimonies are a heritage unto us. So when we're learning our heritage, we are learning the testimonies from the time of Genesis on up. Everybody understand that? Give me Sirach 17, verse 11 in the Apocrypha.
Sirach 17 and verse 11. Beside this, he gave them knowledge and the law of life for inheritance.
Y'all see that? So knowledge and the law of life is part of our heritage. Knowledge and the law of life is part of our heritage. Give me chapter in the same book, chapter 24 and verse 23.
Sirach 24, verse 23. All these things are the book of the covenant of the Most High God, even the law which Moses commanded for an heritage unto the congregations of Jacob.
Y'all see that? So the law is part of our heritage. It is paramount for us to learn this book. These are our records, brothers and sisters. These are our records, our heritage. The next thing in brief, is education. I know some of you don't like education. But education goes in conjunction with learning God's laws, goes with learning your testimonies that God has given to us. But outside of that, in order to deal in this world, give me that in Daniel 1:17. Give me that. When you learn your laws that God has given us, your testimony that God has given us, it will open up your mind, your spirit. Anything else in the world will be easy.
Daniel chapter 1 and verse 17. As for these four children, God gave them knowledge and skill in all learning and wisdom. And Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams.
So the Most High opened up their mind to not just, it was, they knew the scriptures, but he opened up their understanding to what? Read it again.
As for these four children, God gave them knowledge and skill in all learning and wisdom. And Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams.
So we are on a quest, a goal to open up our own places of learning, our own places of educating our children. It's paramount because if we don't do it, it's a detriment to us all. Everybody understand that?
Yes, sir. All praises. We talked about that earlier, didn't we, class? We talked about that thing.
Give me Sirach 44, verse 4.
Sirach 44, verse 4. Leaders of the people by their counsels.
Leaders of the people by their counsel. Go ahead.
And by their knowledge of learning.
And by their knowledge of learning.
Meet for the people.
Good for the people. So that's you, brothers, coming up. This is very important for you. This is what our people need. This will clean us up from the filth we've been dragged throughout our lives in. Men and women. Give me Sirach 51, verse 16.
Sirach 51, verse 16. I bowed down mine ear a little and received her and gat much learning.
See that? You got to bow down your ear. If you want learning, you want education in God's word, you got to, it's talking about humble yourself. You cannot learn anything if you know everything. Everybody understand that? You got some brothers coming, they know everything. You can't teach them. Like on the street, sometimes we'll be teaching. The people listening believe they know everything. Then you stay in your condition. This is not for you. Shalom. And we look for the ones that are humble, that want to hear this truth. Jump down to verse 23.
Verse 23. Draw near unto me, ye unlearned. And
draw near unto me, ye unlearned. You have to acknowledge that you're unlearned. That's what we all had to do. Acknowledge that we don't know nothing. We acknowledge that everything we thought we knew, we learned from our oppressor. Everything we thought we knew, we heard on television. Until you come to that realization, this is not for you. You will never grasp it. You will never learn it. Read that again.
Draw near unto me, ye unlearned, and dwell in the house of learning.
And dwell in the house of learning. This here is the house of learning. When we establish the schools, Lord's willing, I pray it comes to pass, we will establish other schools of learning for our youth, for our children. This is the prayer if the Most High allows it. We pray Christ come back tonight. But if he don't, we have to do those things necessary for our people to survive. The next thing, this category called economics, everybody talks about it. I tell you, everybody talk about economics. This category and or topic, listen good, is the basis of all the great critical thinkers amongst blacks and Latinos. Meaning, when you examine the great critical thinkers of our people like Carter G. Woodson, Amos Wilson, Marcus Garvey was a critical thinker. Economics was at the forefront. It was always pushed at the forefront. However, give me 2 Kings. All of our people, everybody up in here, want financial success. But there's a problem there. Give me 2 Kings 5:19. I want to talk about, I think, is Elisha's servant named Gehazi. Was it Elisha's servant or Elijah? Elisha's servant. Because Elisha was Elijah's servant. Thank you. Gehazi. Now, I'm going to fill in the gap for you. How do you say his name? Naaman, the Syrian, had leprosy. He wanted to be healed of the leprosy that was on his flesh. So Elisha told him to bathe in the Jordan River. Now, the Jordan was a narrow river, and it wasn't as beautiful as, like, the Red Sea or anything else. He got mad. So he said, well, if the Lord told you to do such a small thing, why don't you just do it? So Naaman bathed in the Jordan, and his leprosy was cured. His flesh returned as it was. Then he says to Elisha and Gehazi, what do you want me to give you? I'll give you this, I'll give you that. Elisha said, we don't want nothing from you. Now, let's read what happened, verse 19 down.
2 Kings 5:19. And he said unto him, go in peace. So he departed from him a little way. But Gehazi, the servant of Elisha, the man of God, said, behold, my master hath spared Naaman the Syrian. I'm in not receiving at his hands that which he brought. But as the Lord liveth, I will run after him and take somewhat of him.
I'm going to get paid. Elisha didn't want nothing, but I'm going to get paid. Go ahead.
So Gehazi followed after Naaman. And when Naaman saw him running after him, he lighted down from the chariot to meet him and said, is all well? And he said, all is well. My master hath sent me, saying, behold, even now there be come to me from Mount Ephraim 2 young men of the sons of the prophets. Give them, I pray thee, a talent of silver and 2 changes of garments. Mm. And Naaman.
So you see the problem now. He's lying. Go ahead.
And Naaman said, be content. Take 2 talents. And he urged them and bound 2 talents of silver in 2 bags with 2 changes of garments and laid them upon 2 of his servants. And they bare them before him. And when he came to the tower, he took them from their hand and bestowed them in the house.
He put all that he had in the house. Go ahead.
And he let the men go.
Okay, you dudes, y'all go now. Go. I don't need you no more.
And they departed. But he went in and stood before his master. And Elisha said unto him, whence comest thou,
Gehazi.
And he said, thy servant went no whither.
I didn't go nowhere. What do you mean? I didn't go nowhere. The lying Negro. Go ahead.
And he said unto him, went not mine heart with thee when the men turned again from his chariot to meet thee? Is it a time to receive money and to receive garments?
He said, is it a time to receive money and garments? Is this that time? He said, didn't my spirit go with you? Didn't my mind go? I was there with you. I saw it all. Read that again.
Is it a time to receive money and to receive garments and olive yards and vineyards and sheep and oxen and men servants and maid servants? The leprosy, therefore, of Naaman shall cleave unto thee and unto thy seed forever. And he went out from his presence a leper as white as snow.
Damn. Damn.
Hit him with a double portion of leprosy. Bam, bam. Well, the thing about the 2 garments, just think about how evil a Negro could be. He ain't supposed to take nothing. He asked for 1 talent of it. The man said, take 2. He should have woke up then. Right, Lava? He should have woke up. He said, damn, he give me 2. And I know, damn, well, I ain't supposed to have none of it. The Negro took both of them, took everything.
And you know what's amazing about that? Remember, when y'all read this, when Elijah asked Elisha, he said, before the Lord takes me up, what do you want me to do for you? He said, give me a double. He didn't ask for money. He didn't ask for clothes. He said, give me a double portion of your spirit. He said, that's all I want. And Elijah said, all right, if you see me taken up, you will get it. So the chariot came, separated them. His mantle fell. He grabbed his mantle. He got a double. That means Elisha had great spiritual power. What do you need with money and clothes? And that's what we have to be mindful of. Elisha, who had the power of God. You worried about some money with some man's face on it. You've got to be kidding me. It's like during the time of Christ. Remember when they needed money to pay taxes? Christ said, just go to the river. The first fish that comes up, open his mouth. And there was money in there. He said, go pay the taxes for you and me. Money was nothing. When you got someone with spiritual power, it's nothing. So these guys really didn't understand what was going on. Judas Iscariot, neither Gehazi did not understand. Give me 1 Timothy 6, 9, and 10. Because these great critical thinkers that I was just making mention of, Carter G. Woodson, love the guy. Great admirer of his. Amos Wilson, I love that brother too. Great admirer of his. Marcus Garvey, love that brother. And we just talk about them a lot. What they always miss is the word of God. The word of God is never in their mouth. It's always money, money, money. And that's why it always fails, fails, fails. Read that.
1 Timothy 6 and verse 9. But they that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and hurtful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. For the love of money is the root of all evil.
Right, it didn't say money is the root of all evil. It said the love of it, the covetousness of it, that's the root of all evil. Why? Because when you covet after it, it will make you do things you would not normally do just to get it. You will lie, you will steal, you will commit adultery, you will murder. You want to read it again?
No, read it again from that first verse that you read. You and where?
Verse 9. But they that will be rich fall into temptation.
What does it mean to say, but they that will be rich? What does that mean? But they that will be rich fall into temptation. But they that will be rich fall into temptation. Is it a problem with being rich? So what is it saying here? But they that will be rich. What is it talking about here? Listen how it's worded. And I'm gonna give you something that's been said out here in the world that backs this up.
Can you read it one more time?
But they that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare. That's all I want.
They that will, that they will themselves to commit murder, to do that's anything to get the about. Dollar, get rich or die trying.
That's what it's saying. What was the last piece you said?
Get rich or die trying.
That's what I was going to back it up with. That's what they're saying. I will get rich no matter what. And I will break all kinds of laws, covet, do everything.
Exactly.
That and is you will exactly fall into all of this. That's what it's talking about.
So read that again, Captain Isaac.
But they that will be rich.
And I'm glad you said it. Because you had rich people all through the scriptures. Nicodemus, Joseph of Arimathea, many people. So there's nothing wrong with it if you got it. But when that's your striving point, that's your tackling fuel, that's what motivates you. There's a that's your inspiration, riches. Read that again.
But they that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare.
You fall into temptation and a snare. Go ahead.
And into many foolish and hurtful lusts.
Many foolish and hurtful lusts. It's like the girl or the guy that wants to be in acting or modeling school. They want to be in the highlight. They want to be in the big league with the big girls. A lot of women fall into that. Where they end up, brothers? Pawned, ran through, like that movie Black Starlet. Y'all better see that movie. Black, it only costs like $10. You could go on Amazon. She wanted. It's very similar to Mahogany. Remember, Diana Ross wanted to be a world famous model. She got hooked up with that crazy Edomite. I forgot his name. But in Black Starlet, she wanted to be a world famous actress. And the producer said, okay, if you want to be world-famous actress, you have to sleep with the producer. She says, okay. She lays down with the Edomite. Oh, Edomite, bang, bang, thank you, ma'am. He gets up. She's getting up, putting on her clothes. He says, my dear, where are you going?
What you taking your clothes
said,
off for?
Right. She says, but I did what you said. You said if I had sex with you, I would become a world-famous actress. He said, no, my dear. I said if you sleep with the producer of the movie. There are over 30 producers. He walked out the room, there was a line of 30 Edomites waiting to get their turn. And she's crying, the makeup is running, and the credits go up. Yep. Very good movie. I said, damn. Y'all better check that movie out. I know y'all like this little foolish stuff, but there's some good movies out there. Just check it out.
What they saw where her God was.
Right.
Her God was that she wanted to get rich or die trying. She wanted to get to where she wanted to get, and she would have to go through all of that to get there. And they knew it. That's what happens with these modeling agencies. They say, you want to be a model? You'll do anything to be a model.
And a lot of our people that are in Hollyweird, like you say, Hollyweird, especially the child actors, they are no longer, they're so cute. Yeah, they're cute. Wait till they get older. Look at the way Hollyweird has messed with their mind. Disney, particularly, thank you, really corrupt our people. Destroy their whole mental faculty. Where we at, Captain?
Verse 9.
Go ahead.
But they that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and hurtful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after...
That's the key. Which while some coveted after... Remember, we read earlier, the 10th commandment, thou shalt not covet. That was a law. Meaning desiring something so much, you'll turn your back on God's laws to get it.
Slander.
Right. You'll slander, you'll lie to get it. Go ahead.
They have erred from the faith.
You see that? They have erred from the faith.
And pierced themselves through with many sorrows.
And pierced themselves through with many sorrows. So now, give me Ecclesiastes 7 to 12. We're not saying, like, again, I want to make sure you're honest. We're not saying money is evil. We're not saying if you're rich, you're evil. That is not what we're saying. Everybody understand that? Get Ecclesiastes in the Bible, 7 and 12. God knows some people really warp their minds and twist what we're saying.
When you make money your God, that's what the problem is.
Yes.
That's what the bishop is bringing out.
Exactly.
Ecclesiastes 7 and 12. For wisdom is a defense.
Wisdom is a defense.
And money is a defense.
And money is a defense.
But the excellency of knowledge is that wisdom giveth life to them that have it.
That wisdom gives life to them. So wisdom is the greatest thing you can get. And once you have wisdom and knowledge, you are properly able to deal with money. Because why? Money will be a defense against what? Against defense against poverty, a defense against all those things that fall under poverty. That's what wisdom and knowledge will teach you, okay? But when you don't have it, you just, the money, it's always self-centered. It's never meant for your people.
Go to Ecclesiastes chapter 6, verse 1.
Ecclesiastes 6, verse 1.
Because he spoke about people who come into money and it just disappears. Solomon spoke about that.
There is an evil which I have seen under the sun.
Solomon calls it evil. Read on.
And it is common among men.
That's proof what he just said. It happens to a lot of men. Read on.
A man to whom God hath given riches, wealth, and honor, so that he wanteth nothing for his soul of all that he desireth. Yet God giveth him not power to eat thereof.
He don't have no wisdom, so he don't know how to manage that money. He doesn't know how to make that money last. Read on.
But a stranger eateth it. This is vanity, and it is an evil disease.
Everybody around him uses money, and he's broke. How many rappers you seen that happen to? Entertainers you seen that happen to? Bankrupt, foreclosure. You saw them selling out all these arenas everywhere, and they have nothing because they didn't have the Lord to guide them on how to manage that money and spend that money. That's why a lot of times people bring business proposals to us. We got to look at the spirit of the person. We don't just jump on everything. A lot of times people will say stuff to us, and we got to say, look, we don't know if we could deal with this brother because his mind is not right.
There was a brother who came here. He's saying that, yeah, when we was in the Bronx, he's saying that he had the idea of making a move. Brother just walking these doors, want us to invest
a
in
few
his
brothers,
movies, in his movies.
One he said he did the Transformers.
Yeah.
He did the clip for Transformers. Another brother said that he came with a big movie role. He just wanted to meet you the first day he walked in, Bishop, with a big screenplay in his hand. Didn't know us from nowhere. Bishop said, don't let that man come up here. Take him to the back and talk to him.
Get Matthew 6:33. This is part of the problem with us coming in this truth. So again, we're not saying money is bad. We're not saying economics is bad. It's profitable. Economics is profitable, but in its proper order. Read that.
Matthew 6:33. But seek ye first the kingdom of God.
This is what Marcus Garvey would not do. This is what Carter G. Woodson would not do. This is what Amos Wilson would not do. This is what's that brother's name? Something Anderson. Dang, what's his name? Claude Anderson will not do. There's a few of them. Umar Johnson, there's another one. There's some more. What's the guy? He's a teacher. He wears a scarf around his neck all the time. Cornel West, critical thinker. But this is the problem with all our people. Go ahead, read that again.
But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you.
See, there's an order to everything. Economics does not come first in the place of the nation of Israel. The Most High wants us to learn our heritage, which includes the law and the testimony. He wants us to deal with the education of his word. Then we are properly able to deal when money comes in. But when it's the other way around, that's like putting the cart, that expression, the cart before the horse. And this is where a lot of people make their mistakes, even in Israel to this day. From there, we're almost done. I ain't going to keep y'all. Give me Joshua 1 and 8. So good economics is biblical. I don't want anyone to get the wrong idea that says economics is evil, it's bad, let's be broke, let's be poor. Ain't nobody ever say that. Read that, Joshua 1 and 8.
Joshua 1 and verse 8. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success.
Y'all see that order right there? The Bible gives you, it lays it out for you. But when you want to do it the other way, no, seek ye the kingdom of heaven. No. Seek ye first money. Seek ye first economics. Then all these, no, it doesn't say that, brother. Sister, it don't say that. You need the wisdom in order to know what. Find me the parable of the dude with the barn.
Verse 16. And he spake a parable unto them, saying, the ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentifully. And he thought within himself, saying, what shall I do? Because I have no room where to bestow my fruits. And he said, this will I do. I will pull down my barns and build greater. And there will I bestow all my fruits and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thine ease, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said unto him, thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. Then whose shall those things be which thou hast provided? So is he that layeth up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God.
You have a lot of our people like that. That verse 21, so is he that layeth up treasure for himself. They work, 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 get rich, 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 and they're not about God's business at all. That is last in their mouth. That's last in their mind. The Bible says they are fools. What you got, Deacon?
Verse 13 to 15, real quick.
Verse 15?
13 to 13.
And one of the company said unto him, Master, speak to my brother, that he divide the inheritance with me. And he said unto him, Man, who made me a judge or a divider over you?
His brother came in the money, and he wanted it also. He wanted the money his brother got. Read the see what Christ says to them the next verse.
And he
indirectly.
And he said unto them, take heed and beware of covetousness.
So he turns and goes, yeah, beware of covetous brothers, beware of them. Because this guy wanted his brother's money. He said, beware of covetousness. Go ahead.
For a man's life consisteth not in the abundance of the things which he possesseth.
So where's man's life consist of first and foremost? Where's that at? Read it earlier. Where? We read that earlier. Where is it at? See it? Matthew 6:33. Your mind should be towards God. That's when he goes into that parable after this. He starts to insult him more with this parable.
You know what's heavy about Matthew 12:13-15? We all experience this. You ever have somebody die in your family? Mm-hmm. And then there's an argument in the family about who gets what. People that you loved, now they're your worst enemy.
The law gone. Whatever laws were there, is this total chaos.
The love is gone.
The love,
your aunt
is
cursing you out, calling you nigga.
That nigga took.
But this is my favorite aunt here. I'm sure, how many of y'all experienced that? When somebody die in your family, you become the enemy because they may leave you something. So this is what Christ was going through. Take heed and beware of covetousness. Christ, this dude covetous right
now. I've even seen situations where they're trying to find out, well, what did he leave you? And be trying to find it out.
Mm-hmm. Y'all see that?
Bishop, in the island, people get killed for that.
Damn. See that? So, again, give me Mark chapter 10, 28 to 30. We're almost done. Mark 10, 28 to 30.
Mark 10 and verse 28. Then Peter began to say unto him, lo, we have left all and have followed thee. And Jesus answered and said, verily I say unto you, There is no man that hath left house or brethren or sisters or father or mother or wife or children or lands for my sake and the gospel's, but he shall receive in hundredfold now in this time.
Now, what's heavy about that? Notice what he says, now in this time, meaning while I am speaking. Go ahead.
But he shall receive in hundredfold now in this time houses and brethren and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecutions, and in the world to come, eternal life.
So what did Christ mean when he said, but he shall receive a hundredfold now in this time, houses and brethren and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecutions? In the back, on the left.
Shalom, Leish.
Shalom.
Just like you said in verse 29, it talked about who leave their worldly parents for this truth. Where they come in this truth, they will have all that. This is what we're looking at right now.
That's right. So when you come, your parents, your mother and father may have cast you off. You got mothers and fathers in this truth. And when it talks about lands and houses, all it means is you will be provided for. That's what Christ is saying. Give me that in Psalms 37:25. This is what King David said. The Most High will bring those right brothers and sisters in here who have that loving spirit to love their neighbor as they love themselves, who will not sit around and look for faults and complaints about everybody. Because if you look, guess what? If you look hard enough, you're going to find some problems. But those that got that sincere heart, they're going to love this truth, love their brothers, and love their sisters despite their faults. Read that for me.
Psalms 37 and verse 25. I have been young and now am old, yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread.
You know why? Give me that. Now here's the precept, Acts 4, 34, 35. David said, I've never seen the righteous forsaken, neither their seed begging bread. That's why Christ said, in this time you shall receive a hundredfold with persecution. Meaning it's going to be hard. Persecution means you're going to go through some rough times in this truth. Some people come in this truth and think it's going to be, what is that called when you tiptoe? Tiptoe through the tulips. Oh, everybody's going to be good and loving. No. You have Negroes and Latinos in here. That's what we are. We have the world in us. We got sin in us. We all trying to overcome. Read that for me.
Acts 4, verse 34. Neither was there any among them that lacked. For as many as were possessors of lands or houses sold them and brought the prices of the things that were sold and laid them down at the apostles' feet. And distribution was made unto every man according as he had need.
Y'all see that? So they loved their neighbors as they loved themselves. They were not deceitful. They were not evil, hard-hearted. And guess what? Everybody there had faults. And I'm going to say it again. Everybody there had faults that they were trying to overcome. Everybody understand that? You get people that read the Bible. Everybody wants to be holy and righteous. That's not what you're reading here. Where did you read that? You don't read about Israel being all righteous until when? The kingdom. The kingdom. So until then, we're going to have to deal with the liars. That's why we got to deal with liars up in here. We got to deal with those that fall into all manner of sins. We have to deal with them and help them get their lives right. Help us get our lives right. Give me Jeremiah 29, 28.
Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 28. For therefore he sent unto us in Babylon, saying, this captivity is long.
It was 70 years at that time. Now it's hundreds. Go ahead.
Build ye houses and dwell in them, and plant gardens and eat the fruit of them. And Zephaniah the priest.
That was it. Where's the one about your sons and their daughters? What verse is that? Verse 5. Is it 4 and 5? Read that.
29, verse 4. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, unto all that are carried away captives, whom I have caused to be carried away from Jerusalem unto Babylon. Build ye houses.
Remember, that captivity was 70 years. This one is longer than Babylon. Build ye houses, go ahead.
And dwell in them, and plant gardens, and eat the fruit of them. Take ye wives, and beget sons and daughters, and take wives for your sons.
Talk about families, go ahead.
And give your daughters to husbands, that they may bear sons and daughters, that ye may be increased there and not diminished.
Stop right there. Now, the prophecy was saying that we were going to be in Babylon for 70 years, right? Can I get a witness? So the instructions was to build ye houses within that time period. So why in the world would you have a doctrine that come up today tell you not to do these things when we don't know the time? It's hundreds of years, like you pointed out. Why would somebody even accept to even hear a doctrine like that? To not to sit there and do nothing but rot away. That's basically what's going to happen. If you don't wash your behind, you're going to disintegrate. You don't put a house around your behind, you're going to blow in the wind. This kind of stuff makes no sense. Sit there and do nothing.
So they say, why are you guys wasting your time trying to do all this stuff? Christ might come back tonight. Well, we pray he does. But until then, we're going to do what the scriptures say. Everybody understand that? Get Ephesians 4:28. For you thief brothers and sisters. Women steal too. Don't think women don't steal. Sticky fingers.
Didn't you have a husband and wife stealing together, Bishop?
That's right.
Ananias and Sapphira. The wife lied right there. Watch the husband stealing.
Exactly. Read that.
Ephesians 4:28. Let him that stole steal no more.
So when brothers and or sisters come in, they may have been a thief, but the law says, let him that stole steal no more. Why? The law says, thou shalt not steal. Go ahead.
But rather, let him labor, working with his hands.
Why?
Working with his hands the thing which is good.
Why?
That he may have to give to him that needeth.
Y'all see that? That he may have to give to. We work not for ourselves, but for the body, for Israel, to help it. That's what the alms and all that is for. It's not for ourselves. It's to help the body. Why? Because you will always have brothers and or sisters who are less fortunate than others. So our job, our duty as Israelites is to help them.
You know, that's a heavy scripture for that.
Yeah, go ahead.
Sirach chapter 29, verse 10.
Sirach 29 and verse 10. Lose thy money for thy brother and thy friend, and let it not rust under a stone to be lost.
Because you have some people around us that have money, but they don't see us as their brothers, and they don't see us as their friends. So read it again.
Lose thy money for thy brother and thy friend.
That's why it's a commandment. If you have and you can help your nation, do it. Read on.
And let it not rust under a stone to be lost.
The Most High is saying if you don't use the money to help your brethren, help your friends, it'll be destroyed.
So that brother and friend, is that talking about people in the world? Because that's what people may think.
Exactly. Sirach chapter 12, verse 1. For the person who think it's your next door neighbor or it's your cousin that's smoking crack that want to get a new apartment because he didn't pay his rent. Sirach 12, verse 1.
When thou wilt do good.
When you're going to do good with your money, read on.
Know to whom thou doest it.
You got to know the person that you're helping. Not just some random stranger that come up begging. Or some long lost relative that you ain't seen in a long time. You know nothing about him. Read on.
So shalt thou be thanked for thy benefits.
You'll get thanks for the benefits. Read on.
Do good to the godly man.
What kind of man?
Godly man.
A man that is of God is the one that you lose your money for. Read on.
And thou shalt find a recompense.
It's spiritual. You'll get a recompense. Read on.
And if not from him.
If not from him, because he may not be in a position to pay you back. Read on.
Yet from the Most High.
God is watching. And he'll see that you helped another godly man. And he'll bless that help that you gave. He'll add on to it. Read on.
There can no good come to him that is always occupied in evil.
So you don't sit back and help somebody that's occupied in evil. I got people who I know that are evil that I restrict helping them. I don't care if they family or whatever. The Most High says no good is going to come from that. Read on.
Nor to him that giveth no alms.
Alms is assistance that you give to help the poor of Israel, the righteous people of Israel. Read on.
Give to the godly man.
He repeats it again. Give to the people that you see that are keeping God's commandments. Read on.
And help not a sinner.
So once you identify that this person is no bed, no Sabbath, eating shrimp, pork, crab, lobster, but they come into you with a sob story, you dismiss them. Read on.
Do well unto him that is lowly, but give not to the ungodly.
Read on.
Hold back thy bread.
The scriptures say hold back your bread. Read on.
And give it not unto him, lest he overmaster thee thereby.
He'll take advantage of you.
Because he ain't keeping the commandments.
Because he's not keeping the commandments. He don't know right from wrong. You got people who come through the doors and they'll act like they care about this truth. Right. Remember there was a sister that was asking everybody for rent. Mm-hmm. Okay, she had a couple of $1,000 in the bank. And I forgot who was the one that said, look, no. It's because of her lifestyle why she don't have no money. She ain't care about no commandments. The day we found that out, I never seen her in here again.
Right. Some of them come to rob us. Some of them is not about God's laws. It's not about these commandments. Man, they're thinking we're a bunch of fools. But we here. We're going to watch everything. All your move. Just like the prophet tell the young man.
Captain, could you read the part about the if it not returned? If it was a few verses up.
Yes, verse 2. Do good to the godly man, and thou shalt find a recompense.
Right.
And if it not from him, yet from the Most High.
See that part there? Because go back to the other one. That I'm going to correlate this with the first scripture that you read, the one that you brought up, the one that you gave, the verse in the Bible. Ephesians. Yeah, read that one. Yes.
Ephesians 4:28. Let him that stole steal no more.
Go ahead.
But rather let him labor, working with his hands the thing which is good, that he may have to give to him that needeth.
That he may have to give to him that needeth. That give to him that needeth. Now the other one, go back to the one that you read before. That if it not that if you don't receive the recompense part.
Verse 2. Do good to the godly man.
So do good to the godly person, the person that needeth. Go ahead.
And thou shalt find a recompense.
And thou shalt find a recompense.
That means payback.
Payback, right. Meaning it's reciprocal. The part that I wanted to, the point that I'm making in the finishing, I'm going to make the point.
And if not from him, yet from the Most High.
Because what this is actually saying, that when you're helping your brother, you're literally helping yourself as well. That's the point I wanted y'all to understand. Because a lot of people think, well, I'm just going to give, and I ain't, well, where's my gift back? Right. It's going to come a day you're going to need something.
Right. And so the Most ain't talking about a loan.
No.
Right.
I want y'all to understand that. When you give, don't be looking for that person to actually give it back to you if he can't.
Right.
Because the Most High, your turn, your wheel going to spin around, and you're going to need something. You have to be part of a nation in order for that to happen. That's the part I'm trying to get to, that this is involving a nation.
Exactly. Yes. Oh, read that again. That's what Deacon Asaf just went over. The homeless people that we are supposed, read the verse about give to the godly. What verse was that?
Do good to the godly man, and thou shalt find.
No, further down.
Verse 4. Give to the godly man and help not a sinner.
Do you see that part right there? Are our people that's in the world, are they godly? The homeless ones that's in the world on the streets, are they godly or sinners? They're sinners. If they weren't sinners, they'd be up in here or any other Israelite school learning these laws. Everybody understand that? So we have to wait for our people to repent and get their lives right. That's why I remember the poor man that wanted to be, that wanted Peter and them some money. And Peter said, silver and gold have I none. But such as I have, I unto you.
Right.
In the name of the Lord, stand thou up, be thou healed. Something like that. So a lot of times with homeless people, we'll say, we have the word of God for you. And they go, well, I don't want that. I want money.
Right.
No, you don't help those spirits like that. Don't help them. Yes, Asa, you're going to say.
Remember, you had a video where a guy said, look, I just came out of jail. And they were trying to teach him the commandments. He wanted instant help right there. You wicked. You got the devil on you. You're not repenting, and you think you're just going to come up and demand us to help you? And we don't know what lifestyle you're in? We help you as you repent. You may take that money and go commit a crime. Okay? We empowered you to go and commit, cause harm to people.
Buy crack, too.
Buy crack.
That's what the scripture
says. Buy a gun.
That's what the scripture meant when it said that it'll do more harm. There's somewhere written in there where it say it'll do double wrong to you, something like that.
Verse 5. Do well unto him that is lowly, but give not to the ungodly. Hold back thy bread, and give it not unto him, lest he overmaster thee thereby.
That's the part there, he's going to overmaster you, meaning he's going to do wrong, break the commandments. He's not going to abide, he's not going to take that gift and do something godly with it. Just like you were saying earlier, he may go rob a bank or something, or rape somebody or something.
Rob you.
He might rob me.
Hey,
I bring him in my house because I'm trying to get him off the street, and he raped my family. Hey, the hell is this?
That overmaster. That overmastering goes into, as y'all just say, robbing you.
I'm sure that it happens.
Yeah.
Y'all see that movie? What's the big black guy? Boss. Yeah, but I'll heal you, boss. What's his name? Green Mile. Remember the Edomite? The Edomite. There was a dude they invited in, being Christianly. Let him in the house, and the dude was a pedophile. Y'all didn't see the movie? He raped the daughters and murdered them. Raped them and murdered, and then they all blamed it on the brother. Michael Clark Duncan, I forgot what his name was. Yeah. Yeah, but that goes back to what you were saying. That's what the scripture saying. Don't help the sinner. Do not help a sinner, because they will overpower you and do something to you. Give me 2 Thessalonians. We're almost done. I don't got too much scripture. 2 Thessalonians 3:10 to 12. 2 Thessalonians 3:10 to 12. David said, I've never seen the righteous forsaken and all his seed begging bread, because as a unit, Israel got together. That's what Acts 4:34-35, about distribution was made to those in need, who had need. Israel worked together. So, all Israel worked together. The nation, not the individualite. Go ahead.
2 Thessalonians chapter 3 and verse 10. For even when we were with you, this we commanded
you. Listen, you young men, listen good.
That if any would not work.
If any would not work.
Neither should he eat.
Neither should he eat. If you don't want to work for the white man, then work for yourself. Become an entrepreneur. But do something to provide for yourself and your nation. Read it again.
For even when we were with you, this we commanded you. That if any would not work, neither should he eat. For we hear that there are some which walk among you disorderly, working not at all.
And those are always the ones that want you to help them. They don't want to work, but they're busybodies. Go ahead.
But are busybodies. Now them that are such, we command and exhort by our Lord Jesus Christ, that with quietness they work and eat their own bread.
With quietness you work and eat your own bread. 1 Thessalonians 4:11.
Bishop, that's heavy, because he's saying if you got brothers around you that don't want to get a job, they evil. They're destructive to you. Okay? You have some brothers that will come year after year with every excuse why they don't want to work. Mm-hmm. I can understand if you have a physical disability that's keeping you from work. I'm talking about...
But then you get a check. You get a disability check.
You get a check. Because remember, we had a brother that was like that. Yeah. That was bragging that he was collecting a check and did not want to work and was just living off women. That's an evil brother.
1 Thessalonians 4:11, just the last one. I'll close out with this one.
And that you study to be quiet.
And that you study to be quiet.
And to do your own business.
Do your own business.
And to work with your own hands.
And to work with your own hands.
As we commanded you.
So that's a commandment, brothers. Study to be quiet and work. So when we're working, again, as we've been learning today, it's not for ourselves. It's to help the body, to help the nation of Israel. That's what the alms is for. To help those, and those alms go a long way. It's not alms to help to pay for our wives to get shoes, help pay for our wives to get a new car. No. The alms is to help the poor. The alms to help us to travel to different places, to do these flyers, to get the work done, get the mission accomplished. That, everybody understand what the alms is for? So those who are in need of alms, we will help you, but please have a good reputation in Israel. You should be working in some shape or form or fashion in Israel, showing us your good works. Not sitting here, evil, disgruntled, Negro or Negress, and always got your... The hell is this?
But Bishop, you got the ones who don't give, who's always out.
Exactly.
You understand? Don't think that we know. That's the books, that's records of what you give. So we search these things out. Don't just come ask for money. You hardly give a dollar. But you just want to use the body.
I read the scripture last night. I want to read it again to show you that everything the bishop said is scriptural concerning having finances to help the body. Concerning having finances to help the body. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 1.
2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 1. For as touching the ministering to the saints.
Who are the saints? Israel. Okay, read on.
It is superfluous.
Superfluous means extra. He says, I have to go above and beyond. I have to go extra. Read on.
For me to write to you.
Concerning this topic right here, I have to go extra writing to you. Read on.
For I know the forwardness of
your... What does it mean, forwardness? What? Nobody knows what forward means? When you're forward, you're wicked. That's a wicked thought process. Read it again.
for I know the forwardness of your mind.
He knows that some people got wickedness in their mind concerning this. Read on.
For which I boast of you to them of Macedonia. Bro, quiet down. I can't read like that. For I know the forwardness of your mind, for which I boast of you to them of Macedonia, that Achaia was ready a year ago, and your zeal hath provoked very many.
You're going to watch some of the camps. Their zeal is going to provoke others to do better, to step their game up, so to speak. Read on.
Yet have I sent the brethren, lest our boasting of you should be in vain.
He said, I had to send brothers ahead so that I don't look stupid boasting about you. Read on.
Yet have I sent the brethren, lest our boasting of you should be in vain in this behalf, that, as I said, ye may be ready. Lest haply if they of Macedonia come with me and find you unprepared.
Find you unprepared. Look what he says about being unprepared. Read on.
We that we say not, yea, should be ashamed in this same confident boasting.
So Paul was boasting about the way this church was conducting themselves as far as their finances. Watch. Read on.
Therefore, I thought it necessary to exhort the brethren.
What does it mean when you exhort someone? Encourage. That's what we're doing now. We're encouraging the brethren. Read on.
That they would go before unto you and make up beforehand your bounty.
So he didn't want, when he came there to get money, there was difficulty. Everybody's like, yo, I got to go back. I'm waiting on this check coming. I'm waiting on this. Because the number one thing you hear is, I'm waiting for income tax. It only comes once a year. That's the number one thing you hear. Read on.
Whereof ye had noticed before that the same might be ready as a matter of bounty and not as of covetousness.
Understand that the money is not used for being covetous. It's not being used to take advantage of the people. Read on.
But this I say, he which soweth sparingly.
What does it mean to sow sparingly? Cheap. That's right. You got some people that look at this truth and it's only worth $5 to them. And they'll give that $5 for the year and say, I help y'all out. And they have money that they can help. Or they'll give that $5 for the month and say, I help them.
Deacon Asaph, yeah, Deacon, that word bounty, who knows what that word means? That's, no. Read it again. Read it. That's why. Read that statement again.
Verse 5. Verse 5?
Yes.
Therefore, I thought it necessary to exhort the brethren that they would go before unto you and make up beforehand your bounty, whereof ye had noticed before, that the same might be ready as a matter of bounty.
That the same might be ready for a matter of bounty and not as of covetousness. The word bounty, what does the word bounty mean in that statement there? Somebody said it. That's closer to what he just said there, because it's the opposite of covetousness, meaning that it's not used for themselves. It's used like philanthropy, something like that's used to help.
Generosity.
Generosity. That's what it's
financial
talking about.
Financial generosity.
That's what it's talking about.
Alms.
Alms. Okay? Read on.
But this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall...
Why did he say he that soweth sparingly? Because you got some people in the body that are cheap. And they don't put value on the Lord and his work and what the people are doing. Read on.
Shall reap also sparingly.
Meaning when you ask the Lord for something, he's going to look at how you look at this truth, and that's the way he's going to help you. He's going to help you according to your $5.
Right. Remember in Matthew where the poor woman only had a penny?
Yeah, a penny.
Christ said she gave more than everybody. So that's different than what we're reading here. When it says he which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly, that's for those who have a lot but give sparingly. They don't give nothing.
Exactly.
Here's a penny here. Big difference.
Exactly. They reach through all the hundreds and the fifties they have and pull out $2. They turn to the side and pull out $2 and give it to you. That's what he's talking about.
Yeah, man, then when you're looking at brothers like that, Most High God always take all they have. You understand? They always thought they have finance problem. They wonder why this thing happening to me. Because you cheap. So the Lord Lama, take everything away.
If he don't take it away, you'll be that man that you fool tonight. Your soul is required of you. Meaning death will come on you just like that. You could buy your way out of death. That's what the Most High is showing you there.
if the time comes for you to die and the angels have record that you've been helping, you'll be spared. That's why he says tonight your soul is required of you. I can show you that in Sirach also. Okay, that's Tobit told his son that alms delivers from death. Y'all never read that? Okay, but read on, keep going.
And he which soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully.
The brother that says, you know what, this money is not that big a deal to me. The rebuilding of my nation and the help for my nation is a big deal. When that brother cries out to the Lord, he's going to help him. Read on.
Every man according as he purposeth in his heart.
Why does he say as he purposeth in his heart? That's why we never give you a dollar amount. You got some brothers that we got to tell them, look, that's enough. There are some people that will empty their bank account to help. There are some sisters that will empty their bank account to help. We got sisters who come through the door and they're like, look, we want to give you. I'm like, sis, that's good right there. Okay, if we need more, we'll let you know. That's why he says everyone that purpose in his heart. Because some of you, the purpose in your heart is to give nothing. Read on.
So let him give, not grudgingly.
Not mad that you have to give. Read on.
Or of necessity.
Not because we've pointed out that you're not giving. Read on.
For God loveth a cheerful giver.
So it's spiritual. The Most High is looking and he sees that you place value on this truth. And he's happy that you say, I want to help those brothers. So we get calls like that all the time. People who never heard, been in our presence, they say, look, I've been watching your video for months and I feel guilty that I didn't help you. Can I mail something to this address? Can I come and deliver this to the school? What state should I give this to? Who should I give that to? Give me a contact number. Read it again.
For God loveth a cheerful giver.
Read on.
Yeah, and listen, Dick and Aesop, you know what's so nice about that? By us tell you to give, that should be a shame. That means you're supposed to have a feel, you're supposed to have a good heart to give.
You don't believe, Lord.
By us telling you that rent is not paid, you understand? You know you come here light. Everything, cables. You by us telling you that, that's showing you you're not focused.
In they don't
this.
Believe.
Whatever you believe in, that's where your money going to go.
Because they're the same person that will come here next week and see the school close and be like, where's another Israelite school? They won't even ask what happened. That's what it's showing. They don't care. Read on. I want to show you that the help is spiritual. Read on.
And God is able to make all grace abound toward you.
What's grace? Because we're all sinners. And he's saying that if the Lord sees that you're happy to help your nation, he will have mercy abound upon you.
So that don't mean help the United Negro College Fund.
Okay, and that's, listen to what the bishop is saying. Because you got some people that just look for any random charity to send their money to. So he's right about what he's saying. They don't care if the college fund is stealing all the money, which that's what 99% of them do. They will take, you send them $10,000, they'll send $50 and keep $9,950. That's how these college funds are set up. Read on.
That ye, always having all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work.
He'll help you with everything that goes wrong in your life when he sees that you are a cheerful giver. A cheerful giver. And the reason why I'm stressing that is because you got some people that'll help now, and then when it come next month to help, they'll be mad. They'll be like, I already helped them. They'll act like that was just for this month because they were moved this month. They don't look at the consistency of making sure that this we get consistent help to spread this word and to build a nation. So I'm just showing you that it is spiritual.
So economics does play a part. So again, heritage, education, economic. In that order. Heritage, education, economic. In that order. Not the other way around. Do not put the cart before the horse dealing with money. And then you'd be dumb as hell and get everybody in trouble. Everybody understand that?
Shalom, Israel. I'm Elder Nathaniel, Israel United in Christ. YouTube likes to shut our channels down, as some of you have noticed, ever so often. Subscribing to join IUIC will assure you will always stay connected to our YouTube accounts. We want to do our best to make sure this truth gets out. Please click and join our subscriber YouTube channel called Join IUIC. to stay linked to all of our videos. So again, please make sure you subscribe to this Join IUIC channel to get your latest updates on all our YouTube channels. Shalom.